are you yelling at me? You always travel with the same suitcase, you always put it away, and you always yell, honey, where is my suitcase? Here.
You're right. Sorry, honey, what would I do without you?
Well, travel without luggage, for starters.
You're funny, you know that? Hey, where's Taylor? Did you finish his homework?
I don't know. I've been too busy looking for luggage to check. Caleb? So, how long are you going to be gone this time?
Oh, 2 or 3 days at the most. I'm supposed to be pretty busy with that census exam.
Hey, Dad, you traveled again? Mom, you were bellowing for me?
Watch your mouth, smarty pants. Are you done with your homework yet?
Almost. Where are you going this time, Dad?
Oh, Bethlehem, son. It's going to be pretty busy. Hey, make sure you listen to your mom when I'm gone. If I get back in here otherwise...
Yeah, you'll take all my toys and give them to strangers. Don't worry, I'll behave myself.
I know you will. All right, you guys, I got to get going. Group hug. Oh, you guys take care of yourself, all right?
Well, Merry Christmas and welcome to New Day. My name's Lisa. I'm one of the pastors here at New Day. This is Pastor Dave, and we're very grateful that you are here to begin Christmas together. As we celebrate this Christmas season, the world groans in brokenness and suffering, and at some level, that brokenness and suffering touches each of our lives. And it's into this environment that God sent his only son as Emmanuel, meaning God with us. And so as we celebrate tonight the wonder of this baby Jesus, it's our hope that you are just drawn to this God who came to be with us. Well, in just over a week from now, most Americans are going to set a New Year's resolution to lose weight, become fit, or live some kind of healthy lifestyle. And as a way of ensuring that this happens for you, we want to invite you to come back here January 14th to begin a 7-week journey we're calling New Beginnings, Finding Your Pathway to Health and Wellness. They say that it takes about 6 weeks to establish a new habit, and so during this 7-week journey, you can miss one of the weeks and still be good to go with your New Year's resolution. This is going to be a really great way to kick off the new year, and so we're encouraging you to invite a friend. Be right back here January 14th, 11:15 a.m. for New Beginnings. Well, here at New Day, we believe that Christmas can still change the world. Pastor Dave, how can we be part of that?
Yeah, we do really believe that. That's a conviction we have to our toes, that Christmas not only changed the world 2,000 years ago, but it could still change the world by the way we celebrate it today. And so this is a very special part of how we celebrate Christmas at New Day every year, that we spend a little bit less on things for one another so that we can give a little bit more to Jesus for his birthday. And we find causes around the world, and we take up a Christmas offering all during the month of December, particularly during our Christmas Eve service, and we give 100% of that money away to causes that align with why Jesus came in the first place. And over the last 8-9 years that we have done this, we've been able to build hospitals in Rwanda and dig wells for widows and orphans in Afghanistan and provide solar lights for students without electricity in Africa and warm clothes for Syrian refugees. Well, again, this year, as Lisa said, our world is broken and hurting, and there are huge needs not only in our community but around the world. And tonight, once again, we're going to be taking a Christmas offering again to give away 100% of it. And this year we have something really special, because for the very first time we have a matching donor who's going to match every dollar that we raise through our Christmas offering up to $40,000, which means that every dollar that is given, for every story that you try to impact with your giving, that will mean 2 families, 2 children, 2 stories that are impacted through your giving, which we're really excited about. So what are those causes? Well, as always, we're starting right here in our own community with the Parker Task Force, an amazing organization right here in Parker that's got a great reputation of helping the people who, when we're in tough spots, to be able to kind of get through that with food, dignity, accountability, help with our lights, mortgages, whatever it is that we need to be able to get through. They're there to provide that help for our neighbors and for us when we hit those rough patches. But also, we're going to be building a church and a home in Peru. We're very involved in Peru. and we are in partnership with some folks down there who are doing some great things. We're building a house for a 98-year-old woman who has no walls on her house, and several generations of people live with her. We're going to be helping her to have adequate housing. All of that's going to take about $12,000. Everything over and above $12,000 will be split between two amazing organizations making impact in two of the greatest needs on our planet today. The first is we're going to be funding several rescue operations for people held in slavery by human traffickers through the organization International Justice Mission. You may know this, but slavery right now is more prevalent today than it ever has been on our planet's before. People are being stolen from families, from villages, from cities, and being trafficked into slavery, either sex trade or also working in factories, producing things, and being held against their will. And IJM is a great organization of advocates and lawyers across the globe that investigates and runs raids and sets these slaves free, gives them job training, and gets them back to life. And so about $6,800 is what it takes to fund one rescue operation and recovery. And we are hoping to be able to fund 3, 4, 5 of these rescue operations through our Christmas offering. And if you've been watching the news, you also know a huge need in our world right now is what's happening in the Middle East, places like Aleppo, Syria, and Mosul, Iraq, where there is war and families and children are caught in the middle of that war. And we don't only pray for those people, but we want to be able to resource the organizations that are right there on the ground providing relief. And organizations like World Vision and World Relief are right now in Aleppo, in northern Iraq, and they're trying to get supplies to these families as they escape these cities. And about $200 will fund everything a family needs to be able to, as they're leaving the city, to be able to take care of themselves, from warm clothing to cooking materials to food, medicine, water, healthcare, whatever it is that they need to get to the camps outside of the country. We're also working with the churches and the organizations in those surrounding countries to be able to work with those refugees once they arrive, to be able to provide healing for them and also job training. So all of our offering is going to be going to these causes this year. And again, every dollar will be matched. So we just really encourage you, give generously. All of these organizations have been well vetted. They are excellent organizations with financial transparency, and we're giving more than 100% of that money away, as we're also putting our church funds into the offering as well. So in a moment, I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. They're going to be collecting our offering. Our kids are going to be coming forward singing a song for us. But right now, would you just join me in praying? Father in heaven, tonight we celebrate a night 2,000 years ago when you stepped into a broken planet to begin making things whole again. And we want to celebrate Christmas in a way that is in total alignment with your heart, where we're bringing relief to those who are broken, peace to those who are in pain, freedom to those who are in captivity. And so, Father, we want to pray that the offerings that are given tonight and this month would go to change real lives, that right now, where there is a slave crying out for relief, that slave would be set free because of what's done tonight. Where right now, a family is plotting their escape from a war-torn city, that they would be met with real supplies because of an offering that is taken tonight, that lives would be changed because of the way we celebrate Christmas. And this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd like to invite my little friends who have been working on this next song to come on up. Okay, you guys, I want the little guys, short ones down here. Come down here, you two, you're in the back, you're tall. Yep, you guys in the front, you stand in the back. There you go. Good. All right. Okay, scoot over here, scoot closer.
Thank you. Hey, guys. The seat open?
Help yourself, buddy. You traveling far?
Yeah, Bethlehem. Got a couple hours left. How about you guys?
We're actually headed there, too. Well, we would have been headed to Nazareth till Mr. I Heard Voices over here said we got to go to Bethlehem.
I did hear voices. So did you two. You're just scared to admit it.
Scared to admit it.
So is this a normal thing for you guys, hearing voices and then going the opposite direction you were supposed to?
No, not at all. Never heard voices before. There was just something about this voice. It was just kind of hard to ignore, you know?
Hard to ignore.
So what did this voice say exactly?
It just said, get to Bethlehem.
See, I told you they heard voices too.
Heard it too.
Is he okay?
Oh, he's fine. He don't like to talk much. He just repeats things once in a while.
So that's it? This voice just says, go to Bethlehem? And you guys are like, okay, voice, whatever. Did it say anything else?
Well, it did say that we'd find something very special. Something that would change the world.
Change the world!
Alrighty then. Well, I guess we all better get on our way to Bethlehem. You guys travel safe, okay?
Hey, you too, buddy. Hey, I hope for your sake you called ahead and booked a room. I hear it's jam-packed over there due to that census. Leastwise, that's the news coming across the radio.
Well, thank you. I got back on the road after my interesting conversation with the truckers. But to be honest with you, I did have a feeling that this trip was going to be something different.
Merry Christmas. Please join us in caroling.
Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to the child. Thank you.
It was dark by the time I got to Bethlehem. I was exhausted. The truck driver's words turned out to be true. I went from one end of town to the next, searching for a room. I was about ready to give up and just sleep in my car. I spotted a small motel. It looked a little run down, but my options appeared to be over. So I pulled in, and I went to the manager's door.
I've got one room left. Across the parking lot there. I suggest you take it, because it's not going to last long.
I paid the man, and I went to my room. It was small, but appeared to be clean. That's all I cared about at the time. I started to unpack and was looking forward to collapsing into bed when I heard voices talking to the manager at the door. Well, I pulled back the curtain to see who the unfortunate people were trying to get in my room, and my heart dropped to my stomach. There was a man talking to the manager very intensely, and a woman with him who was very pregnant. She was holding her protruding stomach and wincing in pain.
Please, can't you see my wife? She's probably in labor. You gotta have a room. This is the last motel in town. Please, mister, have a heart.
Man, I'd love to help you, but I rented the last room not 10 minutes ago. I hate to turn you away. I don't have any place for you to stay. Except I do have this old janitor's closet. It's clean. We could throw some cots in there.
A janitor's closet? Are you out of your mind? Can't you see my wife?
Joe!
Yes, Mary, what is it?
Take the closet. It won't be long.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
The man rushed back to accept, and then Mary did an extraordinary thing. She looked me full in the face, and she smiled at me. Can you believe it? She must have been incredibly stressed out of the situation, and she smiled at me. Well, right then, the obvious thought, like, slam me in the head. Matthias, you stupid, selfish man, give them your room. You've slept in worse places than janitor's closets. They obviously need it more than you do. So I started for the door when a voice, as clear as a bell, said, "No, Matthias, they are safe. It was meant to be." Well, you can imagine I was shocked. I knew I was tired, but voices? I know, the conversation with the truck drivers came through my head. I reached for the door again, and once again the voice said, "No, Matthias, they are safe. It was meant to be." Well, I sat on the edge of the bed. I don't know how much time had passed when I finally decided I should at least go just try to see if they need some help. So I started for the door again, fully expecting the voice. Nothing happened, so I walked across the parking lot, and I could see the janitor's closet door was open a little bit. I could tell I was too late. The healthy sounds of a crying baby were coming from it. I peeked in, and I could see Mary holding her newborn baby boy. He was a cute little guy. I knew he was a he because I heard Joe, his father, say his name. Jesus. Not an uncommon name, with an interesting meaning. Well, I went back to my room. A very clear feeling settled over me that I had just witnessed something amazing. That there was something unique about this baby, this event. That maybe he was going to be something important, that he was going to change the world.
Stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth.
Long lay the world in sin and ever pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born. By light of a star sweetly gleaming, here came the wise men from the Orient land. The King of Kings lie thus in lowly manger, in all our trials born to be your friend. He knows our need to our weakness is no stranger. Behold your king before the lowly bend. Behold to love one another. His law is love,
and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother.
And in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we. Let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Then ever praise we his power.
Let me again welcome you to a New Day's Christmas Eve service, and whether this is your church home, or you're visiting from out of town, or someone dragged you here, or you just couldn't get into Ave Maria, we want to welcome you and thank you for joining us here. You know, every Christmas Eve, we gather together, and we focus on that holy night that took place 2,000 years ago, a night that we believe changed the world in so many ways. You know, we as a pastor, I love it because it forces us to kind of stop and think about the incarnation and everything that it means, the fact that God became a human being and how beautiful that is. And really, as a pastor, I love it because I have to be thinking about this all year long, because when we get to Christmas Eve, you come to church and you expect to hear the pastor talk about the Christmas story, which is what we do, right? But, you know, Christmas and Easter, you go to church, you kind of know what the sermon's going to be already, and that kind of creates a lot of tension and pressure on a pastor, because here we go again, right? And so early in the year, we start thinking about and praying about and reading through the story, asking God to give us some fresh insight into this amazing story. And yet again this year, I think it was around June, I wasn't even thinking about Christmas, but all of a sudden I was just blown away again by the profound mystery of incarnation. You know, incarnation is just very simply God becoming human, or divinity being wrapped, or humanity, or divinity being wrapped in humanity. But it's such a beautiful thing, because God gave up so much of what made him God for eternity and stepped in to become a person. And that is a beautiful thing that is still incredibly relevant for us today, because not only does it let us see who God is in so many ways, it not only lets us see what he has done, but it also lets us see who we are. And because it's so relevant, I think that it would be good for us just to pause tonight as we begin our Christmas celebration and think about the mystery of incarnation and what it means for us. I want us to go to a very familiar Bible passage. You probably know the story. It's found in Luke chapter 2. And Luke chapter 2 begins with Luke telling the story of Jesus being born to Mary and Joseph in a barn, because there was no room for them in the inn, as we saw portrayed tonight. And after Luke tells that story, in verse 8, he comes to something that was happening probably close to simultaneously right outside of town. This is what he says. He says, "There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.'" So Luke here describes these shepherds who were out doing what they had done probably every night of their lives. They were tending the sheep. They were passing the time. They were just trying to get through the night, when all of a sudden something supernatural, something extraordinary happens, when an angel appears to them. We believe probably the angel Gabriel, who had just months before appeared to Mary. And this angel has a message for them. And he tells them, "Fear not, because I bring you good news of great joy." Well, what is this good news that's going to bring all of this joy? Well, the angel tells them, "A Savior has been born to you in the town of David, Christ the Lord." So what he is telling them is the first real important aspect of incarnation. He's telling them, the angel's telling the shepherds, that God had come to be among us, that he had come to be one with us. He has entered into our story. And this is the first point, I think, of incarnation that we can take away that's so relevant for us today, is that it communicates that God's presence has come to be with us. The angel tells them, go and find a baby wrapped in cloths, but it's going to be more than a baby wrapped in cloths. It's going to be God wrapped in a baby. That the mystery that I'm telling you, this good news of great joy that I'm telling you, is that God has left heaven. The Almighty God, the one who created the earth and the heavens and everything in them, the God who spoke a word and the sun began to burn, the God who breathed out stars and galaxies, is now in the form of a helpless baby just a mile down the road. That you're going to go and see God in a diaper. What a mystery. How beautiful. You know, the different authors of the Bible tried to describe this in their own words, and John put it like this. He said, "The Word, the eternal Word, was made flesh and made his dwelling among us." Or the Apostle Paul tried to wrap it up by saying, "In Christ, all the fullness of the deity exists in bodily form." This is incarnation, God becoming man. But again, we may say to ourselves 2,000 years later, okay, it's a great story, it's beautiful, you know, it's great to talk about a Christmas, but really, what is the relevance for me today? Okay, so God came to be near. His presence is given to us at Christmas. So what? Well, this is so what?
The fact that God came to be with us at Christmas means, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that he loves you, that he loves us. I mean, what else would explain why God would go to such great lengths to leave everything that he had always been and everything that he knew to become a baby in the form of a helpless child born to a teenage girl? What else would explain it? It's only love. I mean, nothing really says, I love you, like traveling a long way at great personal expense to be with those that you love. It was in 2004 that I took my first trip to Rwanda. And Rwanda is really like on the exact opposite side of the world. It's like as far as you could possibly go without ending up in an ocean somewhere. It's a long way away. And that first trip in 2004 to Rwanda, I had a little 8-year-old girl named Eugenie who stole my heart. A little girl sat on my lap and through a translator told me about her life as I asked her questions. And I heard how hard her life is and how hard it is for she and her mother and her sisters just to find food. And there as I listened to that story, that little girl stole my heart and I made a commitment to she and her mother that we were going to be there for her, that we were going to provide however that we could. And we began to sponsor Eugenie through World Vision. And you know, over the last 12 or 13 years, I've been able to travel back and see her and the family 7 times. I've been able to watch Eugenie grow from a little 8-year-old girl into a beautiful woman who's now going to college to learn to be a teacher. And you know, every time I go back, every time we go back as a church to that little community in Rwanda on the other side of the planet, as we sit with the families of our sponsored children, as we meet with leaders in the community, the same thing comes up again and again and again. How could you care about us so much? How could you love us so much that you would come so far, that you would spend so much, that you would take so much time just to be with us? But that's exactly what love does. Love leads us to spend much, to travel far, to be with those that we love. Nothing says I love you like being there, like being present. And that's exactly what Jesus did in the incarnation. He said, I love you this much, that I'm going to travel this far, that I'm going to give this much so that I could be with you. That's the message of Christmas. But you know, we live in a culture of de-incarnation. We live in a culture that if incarnation is being with you, being present with you, de-incarnation is not being with one another. And we live in a culture that promises us something that ironically, Jesus willingly laid down and gave up in the incarnation. Think about this. For all eternity, Jesus in his godly form was omnipresent, which means he could be everywhere all of the time. Right? But when he became a baby, he had to give up his omnipresence so that he could take on a bodily form. So he was limited to one body, one place at one time so that he could be with us in bodily form. But we live in a culture that promises us what Jesus gave up. It promises us through technology, omnipresence. Our technology tells us, you know what? We don't have to be here in the room with these people. We could actually be somewhere else. That because of my smartphone, because of my tablet, you know, I don't have to be in the room with these people, but I could be here, but I could also be there at the same time. I could be omnipresent, right? I don't want to be with these people, so I think maybe I'll go shopping. Or maybe I'll go and scroll Facebook and see what that person's vacation was like. Or I'll text the person in the next town or the next room or the next country over. And there are lots of beautiful upsides to technology. But I think we've all experienced that there's also an ugly underside to technology. And it's de-incarnation. And it's something that probably many of us will experience in the next 24 hours. You know, we're going to come together in these family gatherings. And we're going to be with people maybe we haven't seen in a while. Maybe we've been looking forward to seeing one another. We're really looking forward to catch up. But probably most of us, if we've been affected at all by technology, we're going to be battling within ourselves this tension between incarnation and de-incarnation. The tension between being present and expressing love to the people who are in the room and checking out and de-incarnating and going somewhere else. You know, between fully engaging in the meal and the gift exchange and that conversation with Uncle Joe, who I haven't seen since last Christmas, or again, going into my technology so I could check out and see what I'm missing out on, or who said what, or who liked this, or what can I upload now. And again, doesn't mean that we don't ever do that. But all of us are going to fight that tension. And so let me just encourage you, let's learn from Jesus this Christmas. You see, the incarnation not only teaches us how much God loves us, but in it, Jesus teaches us how to love one another. Nothing says I love you like traveling far and giving up much to be with those we love. Let's be present with one another this Christmas and this year. But back to the story. Luke goes on in verse 13. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." So first, one angel shows up to these unsuspecting shepherds, but now after his message, they get a whole angel choir. They've got angels all over. We don't know how many, but these angels are really excited, and they're shouting, and they're singing. And what are they so excited about? Well, they're giving glory to God in the highest. Why? Because peace has come to men, to humanity, in the form of this baby who has just been born in Bethlehem. Peace has come. And this is the second real takeaway of incarnation for us today. Not only do we experience God's presence, but also God has come to make peace with us. Why did he come to make peace with us? Well, the angel said why. He has come to make peace with us because on us his favor rests. Have you ever thought about your standing with God or how God thinks about you? And when you do, have you ever thought, I am highly favored of God, that God favors me, that his favor rests on me? But that's the really good news that the angels were so excited about. This is why they were glorifying God, because peace was coming to men because on us his favor rests. And maybe you have a hard time with this. Maybe you have a hard time grasping this because maybe the circumstances in your life are really difficult. You're like, how could God possibly favor me? Or maybe you grew up in a family or a church where you were taught that God isn't like that, that God actually is not for us, he's against us, that he's doing everything that he can to try and find fault with us or keep us at arm's length or keep us out of heaven. I don't know. But this is the good news message of Christmas, that God has come to make peace with us because on us his favor rests. And it's good news because we needed God to make peace. We needed God to make peace with us because we had rebelled against him, and we had basically kicked him out of his own creation. I mean, just think about it. God, the creator of all things, he makes this world, and it's beautiful, and it's perfect, and everything is as it should be, and it always will be that way. And then he makes man and woman, and he says, hey, look at this. We're going to get to enjoy this together forever, and all of your offspring are to be able to enjoy this perfect world with me forever. All you have to do is just, if you want to love me, just obey this one rule I have. Don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And everything's going to be great. Everything will be perfect. I'll be God. We'll be in relationship. You'll live forever with me. But if you want to rebel against me, if you want to kick me off the throne of your heart and out of my own creation, then eat from the tree. And then you'll have the knowledge of good and evil. And I'm warning you, you'll die. And what do? We break the one rule God made for us to not eat from the tree. And when we did, we not only got the knowledge of good and evil, but then everything that makes this world dark and ugly entered in. Conflict and hatred and divorce and friends betraying friends and cancer and war and death. Everything that makes life hard, it all came because we kicked God out of his own creation. And really, that's what sin is. We have to understand the true nature of sin. Sin is not breaking a rule. Sin is saying, God, thank you very much, but we've got it. We'll be our own gods. We will decide for ourselves what is good and what is right and what isn't. We've got it. We made war against God. But God, in his love, in his mercy, would not leave us to suffer the consequences of our own choices. But he chose to enter into our story. He incarnated as a helpless baby, not only to be with us, but to bring peace. And it wouldn't be easy for him. He would have to live a perfect life, never sinning, which he did. And then he would have to take all of our sin and go to a cross and die our death so that he could take our penalty, so that anyone who would, by faith, believe in him could live forever. And that's what he did. And so now, anyone who can come to that manger and bow their knee before this child and say, you are enough. Anyone who can say, God, I'm tired of being the king of my own heart, but you come and take the throne of my life, can live with him forever as it was originally intended. We can have peace with God. And here's the beautiful thing, that when we make peace with God, we could begin to experience the peace of God. That when I make things right with God, all of a sudden I am flooded with a peace that the Bible says passes understanding, that despite the circumstances in my life, things are okay. I have peace. You know, that's something that's in short supply in our world, it seems, peace. You know, we live with a lot of other things other than peace. We live with anxiety. We live with fear, anger, hatred. We live with all kinds of things, hopelessness that's not of peace. Wouldn't it be great just to say, wow, my life is just defined by this sense of peace. Despite the circumstances in my life, things are okay because I've made peace with God. You know, we've probably all seen or heard about that famous Christmas special, Charlie Brown Christmas, right? We've all seen it. You know, in it, you know, Charlie Brown, he's trying to figure out the true meaning of Christmas, and so he thinks, is the true meaning of Christmas in having the perfect Christmas tree, or is it I'm putting on the perfect Christmas program? And as everything goes wrong in the Charlie Brown Christmas, he finally shouts out that famous line, "Can someone please tell me the real meaning of Christmas?" And there's Linus, like, well, why didn't you ask before? Sure, I could tell you the true meaning of Christmas, Charlie Brown. And he steps on the stage and he asks for lights. And then he recites that Bible passage that we've been reading tonight about shepherds and angels and angel choirs and a baby born of a virgin and wrapped in swaddling clothes. But this year, something came to my attention about that monologue of Linus that was just blew my mind. I had to go back and see it again just to make sure it really happened. This is something that has never happened, that I believe, in the history of the Peanuts comic strip. Now, don't fact check me on that because I don't know, but it's happened very rarely. But as Linus gets to the part of the passage where he says, "Fear not, for I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people," he drops his security blanket. Fear not. Everybody knows Linus never drops his security blanket. He needs that for his sense of peace. But as he enters into the Christmas story, as he begins to comprehend the reality that this child is God in the flesh and that he has come to make peace with us, it gives him a sense of peace. It gives him the ability to let go of everything else he was clinging to give him peace in his life. And the same thing happens for us. When we make peace with God, we experience the peace of God. It doesn't matter what circumstances we're going through. As we challenge loss at Christmas and we grieve at Christmas, or we're worried about finances at Christmas, are there relational problems at Christmas? The things that we worry about, even in the midst of them, we can have peace. Because not because things get good or better or our circumstances change, but because we know who God is. And we know who we are. And we know that we are loved. And that despite the circumstances I'm in right now, he's got something better planned. And I'm going to be able to be restored into that perfect world that he originally intended for me because that baby came that first Christmas. We get a peace. Story, or the passage ends. Luke continues. But when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. The shepherds returned, presumably to their lives, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. So not only do we experience the presence of God through the incarnation, not only do we experience peace of and peace with God, but also the incarnation results in praise. That this story is going to change me somehow in the way I live. Just look at the shepherds. I mean, after the angel choirs leave, they're like, "Let's go check this out." And they go to Bethlehem. They see everything was as the angels said. They found the baby. They realize who it is. This is God in the flesh. And then they go and they tell everybody what had happened and what they had heard and the angels and the baby. And everyone else is amazed. And then they go back, it says, to their life. But they don't go back the same people that they were when the story began, because they have been transformed. Their lives are now defined by praise, by glorifying God. Their lives are now God-centered. And in the same way for us, if this story is true, if this just isn't something that we talk about at Christmas, but it really has changed the world and changed our standing with God. Well, then it's got to make a difference in our lives too. We can't really get this story and just kind of go back to life as it was. But could this story transform the way I live my life, not just at Christmas, but all year, that I wouldn't just worship and praise and adore the Christ child at Christmas, but I would do it all year, that I wouldn't just ask him to be the king of my heart at Christmas, but I would do it all year, that I wouldn't just love others and treat others with kindness because it's Christmas, but I would do it all year, that I would live life differently, a life of praise. You know, that first Christmas 2,000 years ago, it really did change the world in so many ways. God became human. He came to be among us. He demonstrated his love for us. He entered into our story. He made things right between us and God. So much changed that first Christmas. I'm just wondering whether Christmas can change your story for eternity as well. Could you experience the presence of Christ? Could you experience peace with God and the peace of God? Could you, because of that, live a life of praise? That's the story of Christmas. That's the story of incarnation.